Hey there. Welcome back. We're back in my garden today, and this is my pink peony. Peonies are one of my favorites. You can see by my hand within here, it is quite a large bloom. I know I say every flower is my favorite, but peonies remind me of my childhood. And they're very unique and beautiful. So let me see, here again, on my knees in the garden. I can get even closer here to see their beautiful ruffly petals. And what is so cool about peonies is when their buds come out, they are these very round buds, as you can see. You can see just a little taste of the color of the flower in there. And then they gradually open up. Here's one that's opening a little more. It's opening a little more. And then this one even a little more. Until they eventually open up into these big beautiful flowers. And you might see some ants on the plant here, and the ants actually help to open up the flower buds. So they are assisting the flower. You can see we have this peony inside a, it's actually a tomato cage, and it worked pretty well to keep all of the stems upright, because otherwise it will just flop down onto the ground, and it's, you know, not as attractive and not as nice for the plant. And as I said, when I was a child, we had a pink peony bush like this, except where I grew up, in the more southern United States. There's the train. These flowers were called pineys. That's how people pronounced it. And so I didn't know until I was older how the word was spelled, and that they are peonies as well. So however you want to pronounce them, whether these are pink peonies or pink pineys, they're beautiful. And peonies come in a lot of colors. There are red ones and white ones. Some are very fragrant. This one is mildly fragrant. The white ones usually are more so. But this is my peony. And it's not one that, I don't know, you always see. So I wanted you to get to see it. And you can see that, you know, as they're opening up at the different stages, you just get this really cool, multi-stage display. And I don't know, you know what? I don't know what that little vine is growing out on the right side there. I don't know. Ooh, this is some kind of a weed. I will have to investigate that. That's kind of pretty. Is that a honeysuckle? I don't know. Oh, we'll figure that out. Always something to investigate in the garden. And here is the pink azalea in full bloom. This is a few days later, after I had filmed the azalea for my last nature video, garden video, when the azalea only had one bloom open. want you to get to see them in their full glory. Like I said, I love how each azalea has a little pattern inside. You can hear the train in the distance. I hope you can hear it because it's really nice. It's nice to live in the vicinity of a train, but not too close. It's nice ambiance. Here with our morning azalea. And the breeze is blowing them a little bit. A nice, gentle morning. And these are my orange azaleas, more fully in bloom than they were the other day. There's the woodpecker again. And these azaleas are really beautiful. They're a very unique, they're a different shape. Usually the azalea flowers cluster in sort of long rows, like on my pink and my white one. But on this one, the flowers cluster into these bigger round clusters, which are more like a rhododendron, which are related to azaleas, but somewhat different. So my rhododendrons will be coming into bloom soon, and I can show you those. But in the meantime, here's my orange azalea. So I hope you enjoyed this little azalea update, but they are one of my favorites, so I wanted you to see the pink and the orange in their full bloom. And to hear the woodpeckers, I really hope you can hear that. They're being loud today. We've been doing a lot of landscaping with rocks. Because, as I've mentioned before, we dig up so many rocks out of our garden. And so we've been making them into little homemade garden sculptures. So this is a little one I made the other day, and I'm very proud of it. So I wanted you to see it. I really like rocks, I'm telling you. This is the beginning of like rock ASMR on my channel. So trying to, there we go, get this in frame. This is another rock I found that's sort of subtly heart-shaped. And so I placed it here in my garden, and that's the woodpecker. Can you hear the woodpecker? Always a lot of good sounds out here. I'm crouched down when I do this. One of these times. times I'm gonna fall over. Ooh, there's the catbird. That little rawr sound. We'll hear more from him. These are some irises here. This is a part of my garden that was very overgrown, and I've been bringing it back to life. Okay, we're kind of close in on some foliage here, because I want you to have an opportunity to play a little guessing game of what this plant is. You may be familiar with the houseplant version of it. This is a yucca. It has these long, sort of spear-like leaves, and you see them often as houseplants. And I didn't even know until I started gardening years ago that they are also an outdoor plant that grows in North America, even though they look like something tropical. So here's the foliage that you might see in a houseplant version. Still some leaf debris in here from a garden cleaning that I haven't done yet, but what's crazy about this yucca is the outdoor ones here eventually form these, let me see if I can find one with my camera, these crazy stalks. So you can see the clematis there in the background and my Japanese grass starting to come up. But this is the yucca stem. So it's quite mighty and quite tall, and this will eventually fan out all these little slivers will fan out, and each one becomes a giant white flower, and they're gorgeous. So now that I've prepared you, I'll show you the other one over here, the specimen. Because it's like, whoa, so it starts all the way down here. You can see all these crazy spikes all the way up here to the top. And these are actually called, these outdoor versions are called Adam's Needle yuccas. And I mean that maybe because of some, it's somewhat masculine qualities that can't really be denied. But they're so beautiful when they open. And so I wanted to show them to you now while they are still in their stalk form. And I will show you in a future video, in a future garden tour, when they have bloomed. So stay tuned. We actually have a few of these yucca plants in our garden. We transplanted them once when we were helping at a garden cleanup day at a church nearby. And we helped dig out plants and replant plants and came home with a lot of plants. And so I didn't really know what these would do and that they would become so huge. But here are two more that will sprout into bloom. So a while back, I showed you the Adam's Needle yuccas when they were just starting to come out and into their little shoots and had not bloomed yet. And now that I'm back from vacation, they've kind of passed a little bit. But I wanted you to see what they look like with all these tall blooms on them. And I have a few about the yard, a few around the yard that I can just wanted to show you the cool flowers. They are these neat bell-shaped flowers. Lovely little centers, and you can see they are kind of starting to fall now. They are almost past. I'll see if any of the others in the lower part of the yard are still more lush. Here are some yucca blossoms down in my lower garden that are still a little more in their prime. You can see there's some here that still have not even quite yet opened on the farm. All the way up the yucca. It's just such a unique plant, so maybe next year I can get it in all of its stages. But what was really cool was when we were traveling farther down, more into the southern United States, these were growing wild, just like all along the highway and stuff, and in people's yards on like banks and things. Ooh, that one came off. So they truly are a native plant, and it was neat to see them in all their glory. Yucca blossom. The Adam's needle of yucca. Hello, beautiful moon. Thank you for bracing us with your calming, pleasant light. This is a Pandora's box daylily, and you can see we have a little friend in there. It's your big moment. You are in an ASMR video, little friend. Tiny grasshoppers really like to hang out in the daylilies. Well, this is the first Pandora, and I love this one with the purple and the yellow. It's really beautiful and has a lovely fragrance. Pandora's box daylily. And if I can get these in proper light for you to see them, here is a hair allium that has fully bloomed. So you can see it's crazy green hair here. So fun how it has busted out. And there are some others down here. This is a garden, part of my garden that's a little bit in transition. That's a little wild over here. But here's another one that's still Oh my goodness, they're so cute. That's still coming out of its shell. And then here's another one. And so they're just so cute. As they're busting out. And we bought these as bulbs from a catalog a long time ago. And they have really spread. And so we've also just, replanted little sproutlings of them all over the place. So we have quite a few of these wild, unusual hair alliums that really do look like something out of Dr. Seuss. The hair allium. And here's our little caterpillar friend who is guarding the lupine. Oh, and there's a mushroom over there. I've been redistributing the garden things. And the lupine has these beautiful tall purple blooms. I really love these flowers. They're beautiful. I say that about every flower I know, but they are. I love the shape. And these are unique because they form. Let me see, are there any more forming here? They form. You can see my weed bucket over there that I weed into. I put all my flower scraps into. You can see how these, they come, the bloom comes on as this large green cone, and then they open from the bottom up. And this is another plant that we got as a very small start from a nursery, and it has gotten very large. And we cleared a lot of things out of this section of the garden this year that were overgrown, and left the lupine so it gets to flourish here and have first dibs. And let's see if I can do a little yogi squat down here and change my angle. I want to show you these little annuals that I got. Let me see, there we go. They are salvia, and they are called red tongue salvia because of these little red parts that stick out from the flower that look like little tongues, little dragon tongues. And they had these at the farm where we get our CSA in their greenhouse. And we had our first CSA pickup last week, which is very exciting. So I'll definitely be doing some CSA haul and probably vegetable tapping videos coming soon. But as a special little treat, I also picked up a 6-pack of these salvia, and the hummingbirds like to drink from them, which is very fun. And here we have a cluster of black-eyed Susans and yarrow. And I love this white yarrow. It just comes up naturally in my yard and my garden, and I keep it under control in some places and let it go wild in others. And it is a very medicinal herb, yarrow, which I have been learning about in some of my studies, and I hope to try to utilize it more this year, but it's also just really beautiful, and I love the little tiny, tiny clusters of the flowers. And this is a white yarrow. That is what usually grows native. It is cultivated in other colors, had some other colors before, but they like hanging out here with these black-eyed Susans, which have a tendency to take over in the landscape. So I'll probably cut these back later when there are more lilies to be seen, but for now, it's a nice, bright display. Well, that one's a little raggedy. It started to pass. These white daisies with yellow centers. And I wanted to include these in my garden tour because I feel like I always say every flower is my favorite. And, daisies actually are not. They are beautiful. I mean, there's no denying it, but of all the flowers out there, they've just never been my thing or my favorite. I do like this close-up of their center here. Maybe I'm gaining a new appreciation. But these are daisies that just sort of came up on their own in a clump here, I think from a previous planting from before we lived here, which was a long time ago, and so I've kind of fought against them and dug them up, but they come back, so you can enjoy them today, and I will make peace with the lilies. You can see, with the daisies, excuse me, these are daisies, and you can see my little ceramic snail peeking out there back in the flower bed. Daisies. So, you know, not to diss the daisies if you're a daisy lover. I want to give them their time in the sun. But their one flower that I could actually say, they're not my favorite. Poor little daisies, I apologize. You're very pretty. These are some marigolds. This is actually just one marigold plant that I bought as a transplant, and it's doing very well. You can see this bloom right here. And then here's one that is yet to open. And this plant has multicolored flowers on it. So there's these more orange ones, and then these more red ones. Oh, that's pretty. And what I love about marigolds is you can plant them in the summer, in the spring, and they will keep growing and getting bigger, and this little plant will bush out even more, and by fall we'll have a little marigold bush. And so sometimes I've planted several of them in a row, and then you get kind of a marigold hedge. But I just have a couple this year. This one here, and then go over and show you the other one. Here's my other marigold plant. Some other, there's one to be opened, varieties of color. And they are just so ruffly and pretty and nice. And I really enjoy marigolds. I have actually consumed marigolds. One summer I found these recipes for making fried marigold blossoms and daylily blossoms, kind of like you do with squash blossoms, and they were tasty. Oh, there's a tiny white spider. Oh my goodness. Will you focus? Will you focus, tiny white spider? She is elusive, but she is very pretty. So many cool insects among these flowers. And here is a yellow lily. One of the few lilies that I have that is not a day lily. This is an Asiatic lily, I believe. Day lilies have very short-lived blooms that only bloom for one day, but are prolific. Whereas this type of lily, these blooms take quite a while to open, and then they stick around for a while. And I love their little stems, their stamens, I suppose. Get back to my plant anatomy here. And they're very beautiful, and of course this type of lily comes in many colors and varieties. I just happen to have this one lone yellow one. I actually repositioned in my garden this year because it was getting crowded out in another spot. A lily. And I don't know the variety name of these daylilies. These are ones we bought at a garden center a long time ago, and I did not retain the documentation. But they are giant and beautiful, and there's another grasshopper. When I finally get this daylily video together, I might have to label it daylilies and grasshoppers. Alright. Well, he won't let me get super duper close. But look how cool he is. Orchestrated by forces that we as humans do not understand. beautiful red blossoms. Look, they really are prolific right now. Can you hear the hummingbirds? That squeakity squeakity squeak is the hummingbirds right now. The female hummingbirds are going bonkers right now. I think they're in their mama mode and are trying to get as much food as they can. So they are battling each other, and it's kind of intense sometimes. Sometimes I feel like I need to wear a helmet or goggles on my porch so I don't get impaled by a hummingbird. Little grasshopper, you enjoy your time hanging out here on the daylily. You're pretty awesome. Oh my gosh. Definitely in another life, I would have been like a David Attenborough or something, because I do love my nature footage. Tiny grasshopper. This one is a Pandora's box daylily, and I'm kind of losing track now of which ones I have already filmed, so you may get duplicate footage of some of these, which is fine. This one has lovely raindrops on it, and whoa, okay, let's see if I can get him in my frame here. Look, here is a crazy slug on this plant. I don't want to freak him out, but usually you don't see them up on plants like that. I usually just see them down on the ground, on rocks and stones, but he is on the move. I'm sorry if you don't like slugs. He's pretty cool. And I don't know, maybe he'll come over here and chomp her on a daylily. That is possible. So then we'll move over here, back into this cluster of raindropped daylilies. And these are mini pearl, is what this variety is called. And you can see they do have this lovely pearlescent pinky gold color. That's low lighting this morning, so it actually, I think, augments their color very well. And here's another one of these big red ones. This is a nice view. This is one in a place where I can get to it. Let me see. Get a little closer. You can see the mini pearls back there in the background. I am so excited to show you these. These are my gladiolas. All the way up their long, 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 long stalk. Oh wow. There's a little bug sitting on the very top. He is king of the mountain. You can see our tent in the background. I mentioned in one of my videos that we've been hanging out in our tent outside. That has been fun. There's some marigolds in the background getting bigger. And so, wow, and you can still hear the hummingbirds. They are active, for sure. But these are my glads. And I am so glad that they have come back. These are cool because when I first bought the bulbs, they were ones that were not supposed to be cold hardy in my climate. They're ones that, bulbs that you were supposed to lift, which means you were supposed to dig them up in the fall and bring them inside and store them and replant them in the spring. And there are many bulbs that are very successful that way, and people do that. I have never been quite coordinated enough to get that process together, so I did not lift these bulbs, and they came back anyway. And they have been coming back for years now. So this is just the first one, and they're different colors. There are some red and white ones, and to be honest, I honestly can't remember all the colors. This section of our garden had gotten completely overgrown with these native irises and daylilies that we had foolishly planted there in our naive gardening youth. And so we had to dig a bunch of stuff out, and these glads were really kind of getting smothered by all those other plants, and you could barely even see them last year. So I did the best I could when I was digging other things up to keep this clump of glads here, and I successfully did. They have grown up nice and tall here, so we'll see what other ones come into bloom now that they have a little more room to shine and show their stuff. But just another flower whose beautiful details astound me every time. Gladiolas, or gladiolis, or glad. The bee balm, which comes in many different colors. This red was some that I dug up from a friend's garden many years ago, and it is quite prolific. Wherever you plant it, it will go bonkers, and that's another lesson from early in my gardening days when I just put things in the ground with a lot of confidence and didn't really think about giving them enough space to grow over years and years. But that's okay, because now I split these up. They're actually a little bit past now. Most of these are looking a little bit raggedy, but they're still very pretty. And the lovely pink phlox. Now there is also creeping phlox that grows along the ground and kind of mounds up and is a lovely ground cover. Get in a little closer here. This is a clustering phlox. I don't think that's what it's really called, but that's how I would describe it, as opposed to a creeping phlox. This grows up into kind of a little bush each year and then dies back at the end of the season. And this plant was here when we moved into this home quite a long time ago, and I remember watching it. Oh, there's a hummingbird. Maybe if we get lucky, a hummingbird will fly into my frame. Oh, there's a little bug on me. Go back to your home, little bug. But this was one of the first plants here in my garden, and that first spring, when it came up out of the ground, I had no idea what it would be, and it goes through some pretty cool stages as it develops its flower buds, so maybe next season I'll try to show it to you in its evolution, but it's just beautiful, and it welcomes me home at my door, which is nice. colorful ones planted throughout the garden, which I will show you and pepper through one of these videos. Zinnias. They are annuals and they do often reseed themselves. And they're a lot of fun. Here's another zinnia in another part of my yard, this red and yellow one. And you can hear a cricket nearby. And you can see the beautiful detail of this flower blossom. Wow, the light's really nice right now on this one. It looks extra lovely. Red zinnia. One more on our zinnia tour. This is another red and yellow one. That's in a little bit of a different stage. They're all really unique. And so if you plant a mix of the seeds, of a mix of different colors, then you get lots of fun surprises. These particular ones came from starts that I purchased from a fundraiser. And so they are kind of ahead of my other zinnias. Oh, good morning. And the ones I planted from seed will come up a little later in the season. They'll be more like the fall, which I love having flowers in the fall. I mean, where I live here, gardening season goes way into September and beyond, and so that's exciting. All right, I'll see if I can find any other zinnias. Danish flag poppy. This is an annual, meaning, you know, it's a plant that only grows for one season. The other poppies I have are perennials, meaning they come back year after year. And I had never had or heard of a Danish flag poppy. So this is the first one that has really bloomed. And it's really beautiful. I just have them in a pot here. And I wanted you to see it because it is really unique and beautiful. I like the purple and the yellow around the red. And so I don't know if these are common in the Netherlands or if they just are called that because of the colors. There are certainly lots and lots of beautiful Dutch flowers, so I don't know, but it's a pretty one, the Dutch flag poppy. So we're out on my deck now, on the uncovered side of my porch, where I can grow things, and this is my pot of basil. It's doing great, as you can see. My strategy with basil is to plant the seeds quite thickly in a large pot like this, and I kind of can't help planting them thickly because they are tiny, tiny seeds, so they just kind of go everywhere, at least in my experience, and so that's fine. I just let the basil grow in really thickly. And then I just harvest it, and I treat this sort of like a big basil bush. And like, for this morning, I'll just, I take kind of like the clusters that have grown up the tallest, and I will just harvest that. And then every time you do that, it just kind of splits off and gets more bushy and starts growing more. So this is a way to kind of have basil all through the season, and I've kind of been letting it get a little more bushy because I want to make pesto. So there's enough here now that I can harvest and do that. And because I will just kind of, you know, clip the basil away from these plants, they will just keep growing. So that's a little tip for you. And I also have out here this big, crazy pot of chamomile. And this chamomile, the flowers are almost past at this point. But I actually love it when they're in this stage. And I wanted to show you when they're like these little poof balls. And they're very mushy. And I don't know, they're kind of fun to like run your hands across. And I don't know, they just seem like they belong in an ASMR video. And what's cool about this chamomile is this is from seeds I planted last year in this pot, and it just completely came back on its own. And I don't even know how to properly harvest chamomile for making tea, you know, how to dry it. I'm not sure exactly when you're even supposed to do that. There is so much for me to learn in the world of herbs, but I am learning. And for right now, these are beautiful for the pollinators. Bees and the butterflies love them. And they're just very cool. And this is a giant pot which once held a bird of paradise that belonged to a dear friend of ours. That bird of paradise didn't last forever. And when its time had passed, I started planting herbs and flowers in this pot, and it's become a bit wild and a bit of a variety, magical wild card garden, which is very appropriate to the person who had gifted us this pot and that bird of paradise. So, love to his memory. He's a wonderful, wonderful friend. And he would dig me doing ASMR so much. So thanks for letting me share that with you. And back here hiding, I have to show you my little froggy friend. Oh my gosh, he's really in there, isn't he? My little froggy friend who's holding a sign that says, Groovy. My aunt, who is also a gardener, gave that to me years ago. And it's always interesting to see which little garden things like will hold up in the elements and which won't. And he's been pretty stalwart. So also in this pot we have some moss roses, and gee, there's hardly any in active bloom right now. Here's one. A portulaca is the formal name of these, also called moss roses, and they come in many, many colors, and the plant is neat because it sort of looks like a succulent. The leaves are these little pointy shape, and they're very sort of juicy, like a succulent leaf. So this is actually the next day in the same pot of flowers, because I forgot to show you the snapdragons, which are so fun. And their blossoms sort of look like little mouths, so if you're good at it, you can squeeze the blossoms and make them talk like a little puppet. But I'm not doing it very well right now with one hand. My husband is very good at doing that, but you can see how they look like little mouths that might snap at you, which is, I guess, why they are snapdragons. And there are a few more moss roses open, a few more portulaca, so that you can see this pretty coral one, those tiny little mini stamen blossoms inside, and then this bright, bright pink one, which is very lovely. Whenever I'm hanging out with the flowers, I get these stains on my hands, which are from, like, the wet daylily petals, and it really makes me want to try dyeing some fabric or something with some flowers from my garden, because they really do make beautiful sort of stains and inks almost. There's a peachy one. So yeah, this wild and free planter that I love. Hello. Oh, here we go. I am the Snapdragon. Thank you for being with me today on this episode of Quiet Comfort ASMR in the Garden. I am a Snapdragon, and I hope I give you some tingles. Thank you. And these bright flowers with these cool bushy stems, I believe, are Coreopsis. I will have to look that up later, and I will confirm in the video notes if that is indeed what this is. And I'm not sure because my husband and I affectionately call it Sunny D. There's some Japanese grass. I guess I should give you a view back into my Japanese grasses, which are huge. I'm crouched down now, so this is kind of a bug's eye view, chipmunk's eye view of my grasses. Ooh, that's looking kind of cool. I love when I get creative and artsy with my cinematography. But at any rate, we call these little yellow flowers down here Sunny D because they used to grow next to some other flowers we had that we weren't sure what they were that were purple. And alright, I'm going to take you back to the 80s, friends. If any of you remember the beverage Sunny Delight, they used to have, which was sort of a weird, like, not really orange juice, and they had these ads where people would be, like, looking in the fridge for something to drink, and the kids would be like, oh, there's soda, purple stuff, Sunny D. And so we used to call that little cluster of flowers that grew together purple stuff and Sunny D. So there you go. That shows you how silly and fun my life is, how random. And this Sunny D, here, I'm going to try to get a little closer without falling over. Sunny D is actually quite prolific, and we had to dig up a bunch of it. This is the story of my garden this year, having to dig up things that I planted just too much of, too thickly, and didn't leave enough room for them to grow. And I think that's been one of my life lessons this year, is, you know, have a lot of things in your life, but don't plant things so thickly that there's not room to grow. Or else you'll end up ripping stuff out later. Which, you know, I've kind of done in my life over the last few years. But okay, well, thanks, little Coreopsis, for inspiring me to share a little bit of my feelings this morning. They're quite sunny and bright, and they do have this really unique foliage that, kind of looks like dill. I'll have to look up and see what they are related to. Here's another large yellow variety of daylilies. These I think I dug up from my sister's garden. I need to have a better garden log of where all these things have come from. Oh, some little boogies. Enjoying them. But, you know, that's okay. Whatever lives in my mind is fine, and if I forget things, it just becomes part of the pattern of nature and naturalizing plants here. beautiful yellow ones. This fun, fuzzy little guy is a stilby. And you can see it grows in this cool, fuzzy, conical shape. And a stilby likes the shade. So this is over in a shady part of my garden. And once again, you can hear the hummingbirds chittering away in the background. Maybe I can get a little video of them, but I love a stilby. They are so, where are you, stilby? They're just so neat. Their texture is very cool. Like, this is definitely an ASMR plant. Looks like something that should be under the sea, in the ocean, instead of in my yard. And we also have a light pink one of these, but I think it has already passed. But they are lovely and fun, and something that it's neat to plant in shady parts of your garden, where maybe other things don't want to grow because there's not enough sun. So thanks, stilby. And boy, the butterflies love it. I mean, it does look pretty tasty. Here's my little fairy girl with a bird sitting on a rock, sitting on a snail. Oh. She's very appropriate and fun for my tastes. She is a gift to me, and I love her. She has a special spot here. Here is a lovely red geranium next to my basil. And this is a geranium that came back, that I bought last year as a start, and I managed to keep all winter as a houseplant, and it came back and flowered again. So I'm super pumped. I have an aunt who's really good at doing that, at keeping geraniums overwintered and keeping them for years and years, and I'm pleased that I've been able to do that too, and I've done it a few times before, and they don't always, you know, last more than a couple years, but hey, it's neat to have them, and they're so beautiful, and I just love the leaves as well as the flowers and the blooms, because the leaves are also fragrant, and it's really, really lovely. Now I'm throwing in a few houseplants here, but I wanted to take you all the way up this cactus, which I've featured in other videos before, but bada bing bada boom, look, he's got two beefy arms now, two. He used to just be one stalk, and last summer he sent up that beefy arm on the left, and then this year he sent out another beefy arm. And I've showed you my other little indoor cactus that is sprouting a million arms this year. This is a good season for the cactus. And I do have to be careful filming this guy because he is quite prickly. Prickly, 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 prickly. He's so fun. Here is another variety of daylily. These are beautiful pink ones with these yellowish centers, and these are very fragrant. They smell sort of like berry bubblegum or something like that, and they are lovely. I say that about every flower, but it's the truth. cute, isn't it? These are some beautiful ones, beautiful daisies that are a deeper red burgundy kind of color. These are another variety on the orange daisies that grow very tall all around our garden. This is quite a big cluster of them here. And then also in the same little flower bed, we have these orange ones with the reddish centers. And I'm out here very early in the morning, as I often am, so these haven't quite opened for the day yet. So we'll peer in so you can see the beautiful streaks of that burgundy brown in there. And there are a bunch of these here that will be opening out wider. So many varieties with daylilies. And then they do, you know, when they're planted around each other, they kind of, they're very amorous and they cross-pollinate and sometimes sort of mix and hybridize themselves. So they're a very smart and creative and resourceful flower. So this is a very special daylily. Its variety is called root beer. And you can see its leaves are this very deep purpley brown color. Its petals, pardon me. And because it rained here recently, which is great, some of his petals have gotten a little ruffled, but this one is so unique. There's only one blooming right now, and they are sort of elusive to see, so I wanted to share it with you while it was here. The root beer daylily. I'm going to finish up by showing you these giant green hosta leaves. Look how big they are against my hand. We have many, many variety of hostas, which are these beautiful green, luxuriously leaved flowers, plants. And they are flowers because they do bloom. They put up stalks of white or purple flowers, and this one has passed its blooming time, but I wanted to show you its beautiful leaves. And maybe next year I can get more on the ball and show you, oh wow, this is an even bigger leaf, and show you more of my hostas as they go through their cycles, because they're a really neat plant. And just like my daylilies, we have a lot of varieties, and I know what some of their names are, which makes it extra fun. Well, friends, if you have made it all the way to the end of this garden video, then you get an amazing gold star and your junior gardening merit badge, because you have learned about a lot of flowers and plants. So here's my little garden snail. Actually, he's not little. He's a pretty big garden snail. He's ceramic. I bought him at a craft fair, gosh, 25 years ago, long before I had a garden. My husband and I bought the snail before we were married and had it in our apartment long before we had a garden. So I thought I'd show him to you, and he could give you a lovely farewell and thank you for being with us on this garden tour. And I'll scan around. Thank you for being here with me. Take good care. Rest well. And I'll see you again soon.